How odd is it being on that side of the camera, or on the interview side of these things?
It's not. What's odd for me is that I've got a theatre background primarily, and so if I direct a show that goes well, I watch the audience stand up and cheer for a group of actors on the stage, and I'm at the back of the theatre behind them, feeling good. But with movies, I realise that the director's often on the stage at the end, at festivals anyway, or, you know, premieres. So it's a strange thing for me.
Do you like, is there a huge difference for you between the process of directing a film and directing theatre?
There are a lot of differences. Primarily, the thing, of course, is storytelling. And that's common to both of them, and it's the fundamental thing. And in theatre, because you, when you're directing theatre, I suppose because you spend a lot of time sitting in the audience as the piece is being made. So, for example, with theatre, you rehearse for a certain amount of time and then you start what's called a preview period, when you're still in rehearsals but you're performing at night time. And so that's the kind of equivalent of editing in some respects. Mm. And you sit in the audience and you feel how it's going to be. And so I'm very conscious of how to affect an audience. And I think with, I don't know, I think with, when I was making this movie, I slightly surprised the producers by, in the middle of my 10-11 week edit, I said, about 5 weeks, I said, okay, I've got a cut now and I'd like to show it to 200 people in one sitting. And I don't want to do cards, or I don't want to do Q&A and anything. I just want to sit in amongst 200 people and feel what they do, to feel whether I'm on the right track, not to see is it okay if it's not finished. So we did that. We had cards where some scenes had been missing, some reshoots, pickups I wanted to do. Mm-hmm. We didn't have any of the helicopter shots that were in the movie at the moment, and it was a mess, you know. Mm-hmm. But it was the story. And so I sat in amongst it, and it was very encouraging. It played pretty similar to how it plays now, actually.
So had you gotten that idea from somebody else, or was that just your feeling from theater?
Yeah, I think that's my theater thing. And the other thing I did is...
Because you're not the only... I mean, like Francis Coppola, everybody now talks about test screenings being a terrible thing and that they're an infringement on the director. But I know Francis Coppola, for instance, every film, for him, it's very important to go through that process.
Right.
Okay. Of sitting there with the audience. Doesn't care about the card so much, but he... You know, that same feeling.
You watch something differently when you're amongst a group of people watching. I mean, it's your eyes and your mind does different things. It's particularly this, you know, obviously with filmmaking, you get tired, you can't see the wood for the trees, you get very subjective, you lose objectivity. And so just sitting amongst people who are seeing something for the first time helps you see it for the first time as well, I find. Mm. I did another thing which was sort of theatre type thing, is that when I'm helping create new musicals in theatre, we do workshops. So when the piece is being written, maybe I tend to do 3 workshops over a year and a half period. Mm. And that is a 2-week intensive writing thing with a kind of read-through at the end. And I always record those workshop read-throughs, and then I put them in my phone and I walk around and I listen to the recording of the musical as it stands, the current version. Mm-hmm. And that is a kind of radio version, you could say. Mm-hmm. So we did the reading of read through for Pride quite early, about, instead of, you know, a couple of weeks before we started shooting, which is normal, we did it about 8 or 9 weeks before. Mm. And I recorded it all, and I took home the recording of the read-through and I loaded it onto my editing software. Mm-hmm. And the bits that felt too slow, I tightened them up, and the bits that felt too fast, I slowed them down, and I added music and I added sound effects. Mm. And then I took that with me when we were recording. I had an audio version of the movie, mm-hmm. pretty much, in my head as we were driving around, which helped me understand couple of bits that needed to be maybe modified, but also the bits in the story that needed to, well, which bits needed what. So some mm-hmm. bits needed to really pull forward, and there's a tricky section where you've got to get from there to there without losing the audience. Mm-hmm. And I could hear all that in my head before we even started, and that was enormously helpful.
So was the machinery of movie making
in position on some level of
that experience, or is that just the same thing is true in theater and you have to go through your texts and do all that stuff, and when it comes to actually making
the toys. I love gadgets and I love machinery, so there's a lot of it in theater. I'm particularly interested in theater. I'm very interested in lighting and automation. Some of the big shows that I do is very mathematical, and I describe it as turning mathematics into emotion. If you have to make automated scenery move at the same time as automated lighting, at the same time as music, and automated sound which has got movement in it, and so all of those things have to work together live to time code. We usually do it on the big shows, so it's kind of like not a small play, but a big musical is comparable. I like to learn.
I think even harder.
To make it happen live.
Yeah.
Oh, you mean on a movie's harder?
No, to do it live, I would think. I mean, I'm still trying to figure out how Matilda works.
Yeah, yeah.
Functionally.
Yeah.
Because it's just a remarkable visual experience.
Yeah. Well, thank you. But the thing about theatre, of course, is it goes wrong all the time as well. So that I still go and watch this movie and I keep thinking, are they going to get it right? Oh, yeah, of course they're going to get it right. And so I'm in the habit of expecting little glitches. But now it helps. But I like to learn, and I like learn about lenses and lighting, what everybody's going. I don't like not knowing what other people's expertise is. I like being surrounded by experts, but I like to be able to plug into what they're doing, and a little. But I think that I'm more experienced in the technical side of theatre. Inevitably, I've been doing it for 25 years. So, but this this movie making, it's as in terms of pride, it wasn't a huge budget. It was a reasonable budget, and it wasn't very much time. So things had to be simple and fast moving. And also, it was the nature of what we were trying to do. Is I wanted it to feel that you're always getting access to the performances, and nobody else was waving and saying, "Look at my skill and technique," and that the direction needed to be that kind of invisible direction. And I wanted it to be work as art as well, and not be bland or banal, but I wanted there to be restraint in all aspects of the design and camera work to a degree. Mm-hmm. So we didn't end up having to, you know, we didn't have masses of crane work. We had a few shots with cranes, for example.
So the decision to actually make a movie, how did that come about? What was the inspiration?
I was missing it, really. I did a movie 15 years ago, and which was sort of like film school for me. It was an project which interested me, but that I didn't think was going to become a movie. I started writing a screenplay on a vacation, just as an exercise to see if I could. And somebody picked it up and said they wanted to make it, and I rolled with it. And it was a adaptation of a play which I'd liked very much. And it was an interesting process, an exciting process making it with some really talented people. But there was something abstract about that process. It was kind of me experimenting with a form in a way. Mm. And whereas, but I learned a lot. I sort of learned that I could make a movie. And then what happened? That was not a success commercially. And so I would be sent other scripts and things like that, but they weren't the great, you know, they weren't the A-list of scripts or projects, and some of them were exciting, but couldn't get financed, and it was a kind of a stop-start thing. And in the meantime, I was getting these wonderful opportunities in theatre. They just rolled from one into another, and so I didn't have availability. I was kind of booked up, and I was excited by some of the new things to try in theatre, stuff that I hadn't done, something on a larger scale or something with certain actors. And so a few years went by like that, five, and then I started thinking, well, I should try to do another film soon. five more years sort of slipped by, and I thought around about 10, 12 years, I thought, come on, like, this is, I'm either never going to do one or I should really try to make space. So I tried to clear out my diary a little bit, so unavailability would never be the issue. Mm. And then go looking for some stuff. And I was reading a lot then and started to develop some things as well. And then the script just arrived out of the blue. So I was ready to make another film, and I was beyond ready. It had been too long, but the material that this turned up and was such a good fit for me in lots of ways, and that was just luck.
And you seem to like working quite a bit. Is that true? Are you a bit of a workaholic, or are you just when you see something you really are interested in, you kind of just go for it? And
workaholic. I
well, for somebody who's considered one of the great theater directors, you produce a lot of material. You know, a lot of shows that come out.
Yes. I feel like I work less than I used to. There was a time when I could do six shows in a year, which is insane. And I'm down to about three now, which is more normal. I don't know whether that's unusual. I have a love-hate relationship with work, you know. There's nothing more exciting than getting a job. And then the reality of doing it is very depressing. But I seem to create in a state of doubt and apprehension. That seems to be some kind of fundamental thing for me. I often think, is it worth it? Will the audience care? How can this be special and different? It's like solving a puzzle for me, I find it, you know, really immersive and draining to do. But on the other hand, obviously on some level I love it, and I really do care about people, in the sense that I like working with groups of people. I like collaboration. I don't like directing is an interesting thing, because you are both separate and alone, isolated, but you're also constantly in contact with people, and that suits me. So I like collaborating with people, working alongside people. I enjoy that. I care about audiences getting good stuff. Mm. I sort of think that I owe it to them to make work which does something, lifts them up some way, gives them something.
So is the success in the success, the degree of success you've had in the last number of years, help? Does it make it easier? Does it take off the pressure? And is that a good thing or a bad thing? Or do you still feel the same exact pressure you felt, you know, 10 years ago when you were doing it?
I think when you're young, so 25 years ago really is what we're talking about, when I started, you have a, I think young people have a, it's like they've built up a tank full of fuel through their childhood and adolescence. And if they're creative people, it's all absolutely primed, ready to throw stuff out there. And they don't realize what the risks are. They don't care about that. It's not part of it. And I think young people's creativity is very exciting for those reasons. It's been held back, and then they're given a chance to do it. And so there's something special about that. And in a way, the difficulties at that age is people not allowing you to do stuff. There's not a chance to work so much, and you have to fight to get the chance, or rely a lot on, you know, luck and all kinds of different things. So the problems and the pressures are, why is it so hard to do what I want to do at that age? I think as you get older, and if you get more successful, and it's easier to get jobs, then the pressures and the problems become something else. They become a sort of a... I find as a freelance director, so next year I'm going to take over running a theatre building for the first time in my life, mm-hmm. and that's going to be different. But as a freelance director, which is what I've been all my life, you do have this problem of you don't get to build up a body of work. Everything is starting from scratch. You start from zero each time. And so you get older, you get more tired, or more easily tired. Starting from zero is sometimes it's a bit of a, here we go again, mm-hmm. you know. And but in terms of worrying about failing, sort of, I don't know, it's an interesting thought about, so my professional life was early days of no real failure, mm-hmm. And even if there were some failures, it didn't feel like it because who cares, just carry on. And then some failures mixed in with successes, which were a jolt, and you have to learn how to deal with that. That's quite a big shock if you've had easy success before. And then you get, I think I've got to a point now where I'm quite philosophical about things working and not working. It's all, no one can take away your inherent gifts. And so it's very easy, we all know it's very easy for a group of talented people to produce a piece of work which doesn't work. And it doesn't mean anything's happened to their talent, it just didn't work. And that's, so I don't feel so, I don't feel anxious about what will happen if this one doesn't work. Mm. If I know that if it doesn't work, there'll be another one. And
so is doing a film piece different in terms of that relationship with it? I mean, the theory in film is that it's a, you know, a director's medium. And in theater, the author is much more respected, generally speaking, is given much more space to have control of what they do or have done. Is that different for you at all, or did you approach film as you approach theater?
Well, you know, in this particular case, the script was superb, and there's a lot on the page. You'd be surprised how much of the movie is on the page. And so it didn't really need that kind of authoring in terms of directing it. What it needed was a lot of work in getting what was on the page into the film, you know, organizing those people, and for example, and finding a way of leading the audience through such a crowded story, and mm-hmm. creating the right kind of acting, the right kind of humor. And but the script, I have a very similar taste to Stephen, who wrote the script, and so we were very much of one mind. And so you know, on one level, it's a story that has got a mixture of straight working class people, which is kind of my background in a way. I grew up in a village in the north of England, and then a lesbian gay community from London. Even now, I feel like a bit of an outsider in London because I grew up in the countryside. But my life in theatre is mixes with, you know, a lot of gay friends and people like that. So both worlds I understand well. But Stephen is a gay man who I relied upon to make sure I didn't make any mistakes for the gay community. You know, there's an anxiety that I didn't want to let down the working class rural community or the urban gay community by making sort of generalizations or imprecise judgments or mm-hmm. anything like that. So on one hand, Stephen the writer would police how muscly or not muscly should the shirtless dancers be in the gay nightclub in 1984. He's very helpful for all of that stuff. Mm-hmm. But more than that, we have very similar tastes. So I approached it very much like theatre, actually. I gave him enormous involvement and status with mm-hmm. it. So he came to pretty much all the auditions, casting with me. Mm-hmm. And he sat next to me nearly every day of shooting. Mm. And I mean, just made room for him and just said, no, he's, you know, he's got it. He's, I want him to be here. And so I could talk to him. I could say, this bit here, what did you mean when you wrote that? Or do you think we need to start off with that? Or could we start on that later bit? Or, and sometimes he would make a little change or not, or help me understand what he'd meant, why that was important. And then I'd say to him, I was able to say to him, what did the real Mike Jackson say about, or the Sean James, or the characters, the ones he'd spent more time with, and I'd met a lot of them, but he's the person that spent a real time. So he was a sort of keeper, or the gateway for me to a lot of detail and depth, and I kept him close at hand for that reason. And when we weren't doing that, you know, we were just laughing a lot together and having a good time, because we see things in the same way. So, you know, I, as a director, I feel that the default position for me is try to have the skill of recognizing the best idea in the room at any one time. And to do that, you've got to listen carefully and watch. And if you don't hear an idea that sounds like the best idea, then it's your job to have the best idea. And but do that other thing first, and lead from the middle is where I, you know, is another way of putting it. And that's where I'd like to be. Now, when it gets to, so all the way through the sort of preparation for this film and casting and all our other work, I would, you know, close relationship with Tat Radcliffe, the cinematographer as well, similarly. But then when it got into editing, Stephen Writer wasn't there. The producers weren't in editing. It was me and Melanie, the editor. And at that point, thankfully, you know, Melanie's brilliant and had, again, she understood the film we were trying to make. She liked the film we were trying to make. She's an expert. She's good. And we got on very well. But that's the time when you really feel that the choices you make are single-minded. In collaboration with the editor, but that's when it really struck me. It comes down, more than anything in theatre, at that point it came down to, well, actually I say that, maybe not more than anything in theatre. Maybe there is a time where you sort of say, you know, this, I hate anything that's done by committee, so I don't mean that. So there is a point where you say, what's my personal judgment on this? But anyway, in this particular case, it was during editing when I was saying, no, I do want it to start off with this song. I do want it to finish with this song, or in the music particularly. Sometimes if people say, you know, it's supposed to be a mainstream movie, that's a protest song, and really? And I think it can be this. The thing about playing to an audience first, halfway through, and then we did it again 2 weeks after that, two audiences during editing, that was pushing against how things are normally done. And so I think that there is a point, probably, hard to spot where I get that it's a director's medium and that some of the choices, but it's really important to me that it was Stephen's telling of the story that we were trying to put out there.
But it also doesn't sound like you reconceived anything in post. It sounds like you decided things, but that you pretty much knew the movie you had made, and
yeah,
that's the movie you edited.
It is. It was 35 minutes longer, but it was, and there were sort of two scenes that I cut, regretfully, because they're good scenes, but just for running time, and the rest was trimming and speeding it up. And the rough assembly, you know, we finished shooting on a Saturday, I think. On Monday, I was in editing and looking at a rough assembly.
The world has changed so much in that regard. It's funny, it's because, you know, 10 years ago, 20 years ago, people would do these films and then they'd have a rough assembly, you know, 3 weeks or 4 weeks after the film was done.
Right.
Now people have it right after they finish shooting.
Yeah.
It's already in.
Yeah.
There's a cut.
Yeah. And, but it was watchable. It worked. And so it didn't, I could see that there were a couple of issues. They weren't drastic. There were a couple of energy issues. And I thought, I see, this is all, you know, it's all fine up to there, but then I got to do some work to try to keep something moving in that part of the film. And people might not understand what that is. We didn't have any of the helicopter shots. They weren't in the script. They weren't in the movie. And I realized straight away that the movie needed to breathe. And but it's all easy stuff. There weren't any big problems to solve.
And this cast that is rather remarkable, did you know most of them? Had you worked with any of them or all of them? Or?
I'd worked with Imelda Staunton. She was the first person I just emailed the script to, and she said yes immediately, and that was... I hadn't worked with Bill. I think I'd met him, and anybody else? Yeah, Chris Overton, who plays Reggie in the LGSM, the two, Ray and Reggie, who dress the same all the time. He was actually in one of the musicals that I did years ago. But the thing about the casting, Fiona Weir is the casting director. I had a long conversation with her about the type of actor that I did and didn't think would be, you know, the right kind of actor. Mm-hmm. And I wanted people to be able to have, to be comfortable with comedy so that they didn't have to play it. Mm-hmm. Often actors, if they think they're in a funny scene, they've got funny lines and that sense of responsibility, there's a few things more pressurizing for an actor than comedy can be, you know. So it's a particular kind of actor that just has got the confidence that they know what comedy is, they know what's funny, and they just they don't strain. And then also they've got depth, so that, because although there's plenty of funny stuff in this film, it's, the situations are deep, and it's natural situation comedy. It's not kind of gaggy. No. So it was, since having a sort of sincerity and authenticity, a feeling of the right kind of working class thing where it's needed. And also, the trick with large numbers of characters in stories is that the audience will never remember characters' names. Mm-hmm. So they have to remember something else if they're really going to pick up. When that character comes back on the screen, they've got to pick up where they left off with that character and know where they are. And so it's a little bit like putting together a band or, you know, orchestra or something like that. And everybody's got to be a different instrument. So as well as finding the right type of actor and people that I like and people that would fit the role, if there were any other choices left at that point, mm-hmm. it had to be, okay, so, well, have I got somebody who's a bit like that already? Or those two people might look too similar or whatever. And so you're looking for contrast and variation so that the audience can latch onto things quickly. But we were helped in the casting by the script, because as soon as people read it, it always got a very positive response from actors. It's actor friendly, and Stephen was an actor once. He seems to know exactly how much or little you need to give an actor for them to do something. And he doesn't write cliches, he writes lovely details. You know, there's so many bits, but there's a bit when Mark stands up to make a speech on a table, which could be a, you know, conventional heroic sort of moment. And as he stands up, the Imelda Staunton character says, "Get your feet off those seats." And this sort of just little, you know, beautiful little undercutting detail stops things feeling like a script. Just feels like, you know, nice. The script is full of that, and people liked it, so they tended to say, "I want to be in it." And it's an important story to tell, so I want to help the story be told. You know, what can I do? And many people in the cast took roles that are smaller than the parts they would normally play, because of their feeling about that. And then mixed in with those group of people were the people who, for whom it's virtually their first job, or, you know, the young people. And that was a nice mixture. Ben Schnetzer sent an audition on his iPhone from New York, and it was nice. Because the other thing about the story is that some weird old mixture of types in there, even within LGSM themselves, they're all different from each other. It's not like there's a sort of a generic bunch of Londoners. Mm. They're all, you know, from different parts of the UK and different parts of people. So it was nice mixing that up. And when it came to rehearsing, which we did a fair bit of, and shooting scenes with very experienced actors like Bill and Paddy, Imelda and Dominic and people, Andrew Scott, playing scenes with people from much younger or, you know, from a different background, and theatre actors mixing with non-theatre actors, and I think they all got a kick out of it in a way. It was the older actors, presumably. I think I know they found it fun and energizing to be with the young people.
Yeah, itself, the story.
Well, exactly, it does, doesn't it?
Yeah. And so is opening night the same in a movie as it is in a show?
No, it's very different. Opening night for theatre is all the press come one night, and the next morning your reviews come out, and then that's it. My job is virtually over, and walk away. And and my anxiety when opening night is, will the scenery break down? Will people forget their lines? Is somebody got flu and won't make it into the theatre that night? And so whereas with cinema, it's a very strange rhythm. The rhythm is so strange all the way through. First of all, making the film involves such stamina, just keeping going with these early morning starts and all of these sort of late finishes, and then you finished it, and then a release date sort of randomly turns up weeks later, so you kind of relax, but then you gear up and you're tense again. I thought when we did our first big screening, our premiere for London, I thought during the day, what am I feeling anxious about? What am I worrying about? Nobody's going to phone in sick. The scenery will be there, and I don't know what it is anymore. It's a I'm waiting for somebody to tell me at which point with a movie you relax and walk away, because at the moment it's screenings and premieres and will it or won't it work? Will it or won't it work? But clearly it's a longer, more drawn-out process, and the rhythm of that is different. On the other hand, you see so many different audiences in different countries, and which is, for a movie like this, that's a important part of it. Will it communicate beyond its own homegrown?
I think it's like a romance that you never really over it until you get to the next one.
Okay, well, I've got to start looking for the next one then.
Thank you so much.
Okay, thanks.
Appreciate it.
Cheers.